Mother snaps her fingers, and his brain opens up.
Oh, I'm trying to think what that is.
I mean, Dalek's good. The Doctor Dances is good.
Yeah.
You gotta see the intro of Jack Harkness.
The farting aliens you can pass up.
Yeah, you can skip the farting aliens.
Dude, we're telling Hunter this, and Hunter's like, farting aliens, sold.
I'm in.
They look like giant babies, and their discerning factor is that they fart constantly. It's just...
And explain that, like, they have an... I think it's, like, explained by them, what is it, packing themselves into a human body, so they have to, like, burn off all this weird gas.
Yeah. But even before then, they're in, like, human skin suits, kind of like Men in Black.
They're
pretty fat people.
Collectively farting, yeah.
But the thing is, they're fat themselves.
Yeah.
I don't get why they just like to fart. It would make sense if they did it like on
the Simon Pegg episode ain't great, and then like
Sarah
the
Jane
entire
Avengers
end is pretty good.
Yeah,
there it'd work.
Huh?
Because their demographic is kids.
Yeah, yeah.
But then the Matt Smith's era is just like divinity. It's great.
Yeah. Yeah, and David Tennant is up and down depending on which season and which point you...
Well, the David Tennant stuff has some of my favorite, like, everything with Jack Harkness is great.
Yeah, all that stuff's great.
Who is, Barrowman from fucking Arrow, so...
If you really love Jack Harkness, though, you just watch Torchwood, and...
I did watch Torchwood, and I couldn't stand it.
Yeah, I didn't love it either.
Here's my thing, like, I watched
Doctor
Who... Did
you like Mickey's episode? The episode that he wrote, Combat?
I didn't get that far because, I mean, like, here's my thing. Doctor Who is, like, kind of squeaky clean. It's, like, PG and it's kind of skirts maturity very carefully and kind of gracefully. And then, like, I'm watching Torchwood, and within, like, 6 minutes, someone is getting their face eaten off in gory detail by some fucking alien and, like, torn apart. I'm like, oh!
Yeah.
Okay.
But the episode that the actor who played Mickey wrote, basically
he
cage
wrote
fighting...
An episode?
Yeah, he wrote an episode. Where it's cage fighting weevils.
Was that the second season? Because I stopped at the first season. I couldn't stand how cheesy it got. But here's the thing, I like those characters.
Like, yeah, that was my thing. I like the characters, and I like the fact that the weird-faced guy from Dark Knight Rises was in it.
Yeah. Like, I,
Which weird-faced guy?
The one they make walk on the ice? The one who's, Daggett's little sidekick?
Yeah.
Oh, what the fuck's his name?
He's also
Roman.
He's the uptight doctor who Charlie Day is
fighting.
Excited.
Oh yeah, he's also in Pacific Rim, isn't he?
Yeah, he's the guy who has to like meld with Charlie Day to.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I feel like we could do like. That could be an entire bonus episode. It's just you guys trying to convince me to watch Doctor Who.
Probably. It's probably one right now. We're 7 minutes in.
Yeah.
It's a YouTube bit.
Yeah.
No, I remember Arlen told you to start with, what is it, the 11th Hour?
11th Hour.
My favorite episode, next to Heaven Sent. And Heaven Sent is like a standout television episode in general. It's a one-man show, and Peter Capaldi is like literally acting his ass off for 45 minutes.
Yeah, while running away from the It Follows monster. So it's really good.
Yeah. It's like a 45-minute display of a man's fucking just, like, impenetrable grief and how he fucking hates himself and how he cannot get over his own guilt, grief, and has to, like, actually start confessing things and getting over things.
Yeah.
Hmm.
It's really good. Yeah. The monster design on that show is really brilliant because they have to... work around very low budgets, and
they have to. I mean, like the Daleks still look like a fucking laundry hamper with ping pong balls, but
And my favorite monster is the Vashta Narada, which is literally just shadows.
Oh yeah, I thought the boneless were cool as shit too.
Oh yeah,
which one? The boneless.
The boneless could only exist in the second dimension, and then they started like pressing hard into ours.
Oh, you mean
and
the
so
episode
they were
the
these like
was shrinking.
Yes. So, like, when they finally got into our dimension, there were these, like, crickling, crackling, like, barely alive, like, featureless fucking ghouls.
Oh, yeah, the paper people.
Yes.
Yeah. They had to, like, that had one of my favorite Capaldi speeches.
Yeah. The speechifying, it ranges from good to bad, but I do love it a lot of the time.
He likes to grandstand. I love it.
He does.
My favorite is that part reminds me of the Sixth Doctor.
Yeah, very much so.
I love when I think it's the Pandora opens, where like literally every enemy he's ever made across 60 years of television shows up, and he just makes a speech, and they're all like, "Ah, all right," and they just leave.
Yeah.
No, and then they come back.
They come back, yeah. They're like, ah, not.
Yeah. It's fun. It's I love how we're talking about something we actually like instead.
Before we roll into a spasm of hate, which I
can't. Yeah, this is not going to be.
Before we do, I need some water so I can hate clearly. I'll be back.
I really hope water, no one cares too much about anything else you know, because we ain't stopping this train wreck.
Nope.
I got 2 pages of paper notes, and then I started just typing on Google Notes because I couldn't write.
Just so angry.
You started typing into Google how to kill myself quickly.
I was on, like, I think I'd had...
Hey, suicide does not... Should not talk about lightly.
After watching Spawn, does.
Yeah, I was,
Oh, shit, Resident Evil Outbreak, I gotta watch this.
Oh, yeah, I started watching that, too. Man, that game looks like shit.
I love that Lucky Ted is in the, fake movie.
Oh, yeah. I really, that, the latest one they have is probably my favorite out of all of them.
Yeah, because it's Resident Evil Outbreak.
Yeah. Or, I mean, the intro.
Oh, yeah.
Alright.
You want me to start in, or what?
How do we start this episode?
Welcome to the first episode movie special of Phantom Zone Podcast.
Welcome to the Phantom Zone Spawn Special.
Yeah, welcome to the first movie special this week. This edition will be Spawn, the worst movie ever made.
Yep. Yeah, that's what you're going with.
Okay, so you want me to start in? Or are we doing that? I don't know.
Yeah, are we ready?
Yeah, I am.
Oh, wait.
Okay, who's locking the doors?
Please don't lock me in here.
I'm going to close the door. He's like, my hate.
Don't leave me with these people.
All right. This is going to be fun.
I am legitimately excited.
Yeah.
Okay. We good?
Are we? Yeah. I'm wondering.
Alan?
Yeah.
All right.
Hunter? I'm still here.
Hey.
Okay. And am I jumping in or is someone else jumping in?
Do you want to do intros first or do you want to do the intros after?
I mean, well, we do the intros after, like, we'll continue to do that, I think.
Can I just jump us in with a very good description of what I think this movie is and we can just jump off from there?
Well, I mean, we gotta do some sort of an intro, right?
Yeah, do your the Spawn special, and I'm gonna do my...
Okay, yeah, so you'll go first.
Okay. ...quote that I told him that I was gonna do.
Okay. Hello, and welcome to the first movie special of the Phantom Zone podcast. This edition, we will be talking about Spawn, the... worst movie made in 1990 that we apparently might get another one from McFarlane, depending on how it goes. Anyway, let's talk about some Spawn.
What an asinine piece of shit.
Okay.
This movie fucking sucks.
Matt Curione, that was for you. Anyway.
Okay, podcast over. That's it. We're
yeah,
good.
Let's just wrap it up.
Close it up.
This episode I've ever had to do. Good God. Arlen, Alan.
Hey. Spawn's design is cool.
That suit is bitchin'. Everything else in this movie is dog shit.
Yeah, except he doesn't wear the mask for like half the movie. Fucking piss me off so much.
Pepperoni face. I look like pepperoni and I'm walking around doing my... It's so bad. And Michael Jai White cannot act at all.
That poor, like, I felt bad for him. Because, like...
He was... It's funny, like, if we're going to start anywhere, I guess it's the goddamn beginning. Like, before he becomes Hellspawn, he is the stiffest actor this side of Hayden Christensen.
Yes. He is Christensen levels of terrible.
Nothing you can do to change your mind? No, you can't. All right, then.
Yeah, he's, the whole time he had that weird gruff voice, like... You're just trying to be a badass the whole time, and like, I'm not buying this at all.
Yeah.
It's weird if you go watch him in Black Dynamite, where he's like he's a shining star of charisma and comedy timing.
But Black Dynamite, I sell drugs to the community.
I am.
Wait, you mean that, like, he isn't always terrible?
Oh, no, yeah. He's incredible and stuff. He, like...
Yeah. Dark like, Knight? What happened in this movie? Had, like, how did he just all of a sudden just...
He had nothing
act.
Good to say about playing.
Poor direction, probably.
Yeah. The director of this went on to do absolutely nothing. So.
Who wrote this movie?
I think it was a career ender.
Yeah.
This movie got him and put him in Hollywood jail for, like, ever.
Because I think Blade 2, I think. Or no, Blade. Blade 1.
No,
yeah, Blade 1, and then he did this.
It's not the same guy.
No, it's not. I looked this up earlier.
Because these came out a year apart, so... Which is crazy.
Continue.
No, he was directed by... It was directed by... I'm going to have it
Mark A.Z. Dippe.
There we go. And he did... His filmography is less than a page.
Yeah. He's mostly a ILM visual effects artist.
Yeah.
That's the majority of his work.
It's got three writers, Mark being one of them. I think the only thing this guy did of note after Spawn was... Some Garfield crap.
That makes total sense.
Wait, I'm sorry. Yeah, in 2004, he directed the sci-fi classic Frankenfish.
We
all know that movie. Frankenfish.
I would rather, you know what? I would rather watch Frankenfish.
Seriously, I would.
He was also instrumental in making the T-1000 for Terminator 2.
Right. Okay. So I want to point something out. The best looking sequence of this film, as far as special effects, is the stuff with the Violator.
Yeah, you know what? I was expecting, like, going into that scene, just from what I'd, like, everything leading up to it, like, with Malbolgia looking like a Beast Wars character.
Yeah, what happened to Malbolgia?
Why doesn't his mouth move?
He doesn't speak. His mouth doesn't...
It's funny, because...
He sounds like Soundwave from the Transformers movie.
Towards the end, where after Spawn like goes down there and like kills what's his face, the
Malbolgia?
Clown, yeah,
Violator?
Yeah,
oh Violet, Malbolgia. Yeah, Violet,
yeah, they both look the same to me, but he like closes up on his eyes and he's talking and you can like see the warping in his nostril when he's talking. It's just, they just didn't try at all. It just looks bad.
And as I say,
well, all the
why the fuck was Frank Welker the voice of Malbolgia?
Oh shit, he was the voice of Malbolgia.
It was Frank Welker?
Yeah,
it was Frank fucking Welker.
Holy shit!
Oh, excuse me, I was confusing my terrible movies. The director of Blade also directed League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Yes,
continue.
That's gonna be an episode.
Well, there's your fucking reference, Chris.
Understandable.
A look into the dark future. Eventually, we're probably going to watch just a League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, and that'll be the episode where Connor puts a gun in his mouth and pulls the trigger. I don't know which movie I hate more, this one or League. I think I might watch League over this one.
Well, we're going to
know what good movies
are. The Violator stuff. No, the Violator scene was really cool because leading into it with Malbolgia looking as terrible as he did and other stuff, I was like, oh, that's going to be crap. And then, surprise, surprise, it's basically all puppeteering.
Yeah, it's puppeteering.
Well, it was a mix of puppeteering and CGI.
Yeah, it was mostly like close-up puppeteering, and like it looked for the time where comic book movies weren't being very authentic, this is one of the most authentic-looking adaptations of a character I've ever seen.
Yeah, and it makes complete sense. Because this guy worked on Jurassic Park, I know that, and he even says, because I remember buying this movie on DVD, watching special features, and having him say, these are the same people that worked on Jurassic Park, I was on Jurassic Park, all this stuff, so it makes sense that makes sense.
That's
the best scene in the movie.
And like we said, everything practical, because this is one of the glowing things about this movie, everything practical looks awesome, even like...
Oh, yeah. It was ILM, wasn't it?
Suit looks
it's all ILM.
Yeah, the suit looks good, and even his like makeup is all right. I mean, it's not.
Yeah, looks like pepperoni, but it's still good.
Yeah, like, you can tell he's burnt, at least. Yeah.
Or supposed to be.
Yeah.
Also, it doesn't do much for his acting when like his face can't move.
Yeah.
He's just like delivering. It's all vocal and like some of the, and Michael Jai White isn't. Really, the biggest problem about his performance, I think it's just the writing was shit, too. Like, he has to say some dumb things.
Yeah, he does.
Oh, yeah. DePay also was part... He was half of the screenwriting team.
Is that why he felt he had to roundhouse kick at least three people in this movie?
I have that in my mind.
Why did he roundhouse kick Jason Wynn at the end of the movie? He's like, I'm going to kill you. And then he Chuck Norris is him. And looks like roundhouse kicks him through a double door.
That whole sequence is stupid. That made me so mad just watching that.
I hate to break this to you, Hunter, but this whole movie was stupid.
Yeah, no, I agree. But just like how quickly he falls for the violator's shit, because like when he stabs her you could see like the green slime like coming out of the eye, like how do you not know that's not him?
And then like something else I'm gonna say about this movie is like everything happens in a breath. Like I remember seeing the Red Letter Media critique of episode one saying the editing was like a disaster because in like 90 seconds you'd go from like space, ground, inside of a ship, back to the ground, back to space, inside of a ship, back to the ground, and, like, you can see, I mean, there's footage of, like, an editor, like, talking to George Lucas going, like, this is insane. Like, you have all these cuts inside of a short period of time, and in Spawn, you have all these things that are supposed to be kind of meaningful happen in, like, a six-second window, and then, boom, fiery transition to the next scene, and then something happens, and then, boom, fiery transition to the next scene.
Yeah, or,
Let's talk about the story for one quick second. Where was it? Like, because I'm generally lost as to, like, what exactly the whole motivation of being Spawn was.
Is that Malbolgia needed a captain for his armies, and he was, I suppose, working in cahoots with Jason Wynn, who had a doomsday weapon. Why, I don't know. He gives him Simmons by betraying him, and then somehow 5 years has to pass, and then
he wakes up looking like pepperoni.
And he wakes up looking like a brownie.
That someone shit on.
Yeah, in like a zombie suit. And then like, this is where I got lost, because I was like, okay, so Malbolgia needs Spawn to lead his armies, but instead of just making him do it, he's for some reason letting him wander around like a lost kid, and then he's double playing Wynn because he's tricking Spawn into killing Wynn so the pacemaker will go off and blow up this doomsday weapon that's also tied to his heart, and
the whole plan is a little bit the most roundabout way to go about this.
I'm sorry, first of all, Malbolgia is basically the devil, just burn the place down. What are you doing?
Yeah.
What do you need, Jason? What do you need Martin Sheen for?
Yeah, it makes sense.
I'm surprised they got him at all.
Like, a bus or something. Like, he never moves from that spot.
If you have an army, just let him loose. Why do you... You have an army of necroplasmic-powered fucking super soldiers.
Right. like, it makes no sense.
We're all apparently useless because Spawn takes them all out within seconds.
Yeah, like...
No sense whatsoever. Like,
do they ever explain why Spawn is the one that they want to lead them?
Do they ever explain how Spawn did it in the first place? He just does it.
Because he's a perfect soldier, but here's the thing. If he's still only, like, if he's not on his side already, why would he be able to kill them all? Like, if he was an established Spawn and he had, like, already sold himself to Malvolgia, that would make sense. But I think the idea is that he has to kill Wynn to get his full power or to finalize his deal with Devil. I don't really understand it at all.
Well, again, that goes why he's doing the pacing of this movie is garbage. So, like, even if you want to dwell on something for a little bit to think about it, you don't have time because between spouts of, you know, exposition, you get these, like, stupid as hell action sequences, like that terrible motorcycle chase.
Yeah. It's just dog shit. So much of this movie is dog shit. And
it's filled with bizarre narration that's, like, just over the top. Like, a man comes in with a voice like this and tells you what you're about to see.
Yeah.
I thought I thought it was the narrator from Survivor or SummerSlam 2003.
He was like a wrestling narrator. God. This Sunday, Spawn and Jason Wynn in the cage.
It was Nicole Williamson.
Everyone is underwhelmed.
Yeah.
There'll be no asses in these seats.
Oh, the guy who played him is dead.
Wait, what?
The guy who played
him is dead?
I hope he did something else before he died.
Yeah.
Look, you can't all go out on top like Spawn, movie, okay?
Spawn was the last thing he did.
Oh, that's sad. That's sad. Rip.
Collective sigh of disappointment.
I'm pouring one just out.
Maybe Spawn killed him.
Like I said, you can't go out on top like Raul Julia going out making an undisputed cult classic.
Yeah.
Wait, did he Street Fighter the movie was his last movie, right?
Dude, he died like basically as soon as it wrapped or like basically close to it being finished. And the story was, and I mean we're gonna go off top a little bit in this episode, it's fine. The story about Raul Julia, I guess, is that he showed up to filming like sick as shit from cancer treatments and all kinds of stuff. And they had to like pump him full of like food and medicine just to like basically keep him upwards to film. That's why he looks so thin and weird in Street Fighter. He's basically dying the whole time.
Rip.
Yeah, like, and
poor dude.
And now that I go back and watch that movie, I couldn't have asked for a better performance. Like, he is the shining light of that movie.
Yeah, he kills it every scene he's in.
Everyone looks like they're phoning it in, except Raul Julia, who delivers lines like "I wish to murder him gracefully in the glory of battle, and then I shall break his spine."
Yeah, and I mean the line that a lot of people like to quote is "What was the worst day of your life for you?" Or you know, "Was well, just me, another day."
For me, it was Tuesday.
Yeah, it's just
Raul Julia's cause of death?
I think it was just cancer related.
Yeah,
cancer. Yeah, because Nicole Williamson, he died of cancer too.
Wow. God. I mean, maybe bad movies can accelerate cancer.
But why is Jean-Claude Van Damme still around? That's not. I shouldn't say that. But I mean, if we're gonna compare the two, I mean, Jean-Claude Van Damme is having like a blast in Spawn, and like I don't know, no one in Spawn looks like they're okay. That's not true because we haven't talked about John Leguizamo yet.
Oh, God.
Oh, no.
John Leguizamo, as Arlen said, the best...
He was made for this part.
Yeah, he was. And for whatever reason, like, the writers must have known that a little too well and gave him two-thirds of the script.
Mm-hmm.
He says the most of anybody. He has the most lines. He has the most...
Like, you might as well call this movie, like, The Violator. Like...
Yeah.
They had something with him, and they consistently botched it moments later, because I'd laugh at him, and then he'd, like, fart.
Yeah.
I have a theory. I think what happened is they shot everybody's scenes. They shot an extra 20 hours of him, just because of, like, him improvising and being a comedian and just going off and being John Leguizamo. And then what happened is they got into the editing room and they realized everybody else was terrible. So they just dove into those extra scenes, and they just edited those together around the terribleness.
That fucking cheerleading sequence.
Yeah, Fawn, what the Fawn, heck? He's our man, whatever, whatever.
It's just... Age of the On.
It's so... It's so crazy.
It's like...
It makes no sense.
Well, in the movie, it's supposed to be like... It's that scene in particular is so out of place because the movie is being built from the start as a like dark, brooding, you know, undead superhero movie.
Right.
And then you are literally thrust into John Leguizamo and as a clown in a fat suit, in a cheerleader outfit, doing a cheer routine. And then immediately you're thrown back into hell and like the fucking Beast Wars character is yelling at him and then it's right back to like business as usual.
So, something I wasn't sure about. Did Malboja have a beard, or was it just fire around his around his head?
I don't know. His face
I think you're putting too much thought into this, Alan.
It didn't matter if he had a beard.
More thought than they did.
Putting more thought than the people that made it. I have so many things. Like, the first thing I wrote on my notes is, so many arachnids, because Wynn has an ashtray with scorpions in it, and if you haven't seen the movie, I'm not sorry. I'm glad that you skipped this.
Yeah. I'm actually a little jealous.
I'm really jealous of everyone who's gotten to avoid this movie. But he has what looks like a fish tank with scorpions in it, and then he has an ashtray in the middle, and he has two scorpions that are fighting. But then we cut to Priest, Priest who is played.
Wanda Clark from the OC.
Who is a throwaway character at best.
Well, they couldn't use
a tarantula.
Or
yeah, they couldn't, just playing they couldn't with use, tarantula.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. She is playing with tarantula.
She has no lines in that movie. I just realized. She says nothing, almost.
She does, but like a lot of it is just it's a waste of time.
Like, I don't even remember what she said.
In the party scene, she has a lot of lines, but it's mostly just, Simmons! Simmons? Simmons? It's different versions of Simmons. It's just the same word over and over again.
Like, during the whole party sequence, like, Martin Sheen is also going like, Simmons? Simmons!
It's Simmons!
It's Simmons!
How do they know Simmons. It's Simmons?
That thing is Simmons!
Because he says it. He says it. You murdered me in that Korean factory.
Wait, how many people?
I mean, I will say, Melinda
are you the
Clark
first person or the second person they killed in the Korean factory?
Yeah, seriously, Melinda Clark is like, though, for her short period of screen time, she's mesmerizing to look at. Too bad she's like a wasted character because they can't have not they couldn't have they just didn't use. What the fuck is his name? Chapel?
Yeah, Chapel. From Youngblood. Yeah.
Who is a way cooler character who actually has a personal tie to Al Simmons. In the comics, the one who killed him. And then, like, goes on to become a mainstay Image character for a long period of time.
And A6 was something created for the movie. In the comics, Al Simmons worked for the CIA.
Yeah, and he was killed in, wasn't he killed in Vietnam, I think? Or some kind of, he was killed in
I can't remember the exact specifics. It's been a while since I read Spawn. I think the biggest disappointment for me for this whole movie is that Jason Wynn never became the Redeemer.
I feel like they were saving that for the sequel.
Yeah.
God, the one.
Oh yeah, not to mention there's two other films after this.
Wait, what?
There's three Spawn movies.
Did they really make three Spawn movies?
They did not make three Spawn movies.
Or two and an animated one.
No. Chris, they made one live-action movie, and then the animated series
That was actually a mini-series.
It's release and like, how do you... Its release is weird, because they call Spawn 3...
The Recall.
Well, it's basically like it's three animated episodes, but each animated episode's like an hour long.
Mm. I'm looking at Spawn 2 right now, actually, and it's a cartoon.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Spawn was, I think, it was three episodes on HBO. They were about an hour long. And then Spawn 2 was, I think, about two or three episodes, an hour long apiece. And then Spawn 3 was the same thing. Because there's six episodes. I have them on my PC. I've been watching them because I've had to cleanse my body of this fucking movie. And
it sounds like Michael J. White is Spawn.
That's Keith David.
No.
Ooh.
Spawn 2, it's
Spawn 2, the full HBO movie, which is 2.5 hours long, is on YouTube.
And it is Michael J. White in Spawn 2.
Okay, I've never heard of this.
Yeah, apparently it's alright.
Maybe what they did is they recut the animation and put Michael J. White's voice in it. That's what
it's like official.
No, it...
Todd McFarlane's
Spawn 2. No, that's not what I mean. I mean, like, the studio did that. They recut the HBO animation, and then they re-recorded new tracks. It's not something that's completely out of...
Yeah, here's the thing on... There was a sequel that was in development hell for about 10 years.
As it rightfully should be.
Yeah, because we don't need Spawn.
Originally, the sequel would have focused on Sam and Twitch and have Spawn without a speaking part, like, and have it be like a Gotham Central.
I mean, the less Spawn says, the more effective he is, because it's why I like the animated series so much, is because they treat him like a ghost. And his presence is mostly, you rarely get a full view of Spawn in the animated series. You see his cape, his eyes, and the decals on his mask, and that's really it. He lives in the shadows, and, like, you get to see him act mostly off camera, it's mostly him delivering dialogue from the shadows.
Yeah. Him as an action hero makes very little sense.
No sense, because... His characterization in, from what I've read in, like, the comics and the anime show, was like, he just wants to be left the fuck alone.
Yeah. Like, it works in the video game Spawn Armageddon. I don't know if anybody's ever played this. It's
a long time ago.
Yeah. Have you played it recently?
It's like Arkham before Arkham, though. It's basically Arkham City, but without the same level of controls.
Okay.
And it's
by the way, if anyone's interested in watching the Spawn animated series, it's on Amazon Prime.
I have it. I obtained it.
Right.
He started looking elsewhere.
Right. legally.
You found it at the local video store?
The local video store called
and you have not
The Bay with
Blockbuster. You haven't to anybody.
Called
no,
Buccaneer.
I haven't. It is called mine. Blockbuster. Yeah, it's called the Beach.
Buccaneer Cove.
Yes, that's where I obtained it.
Legally.
Yeah.
Legally. With money.
With cash money.
Yeah.
In exchange.
This movie. God damn it. I'm just gonna read off some of my notes.
Go ahead, because I mean,
in
like...
In case we didn't understand who it is. There's constant reminders of who people are in this movie. Again.
You just went over that one.
So, we actually know who Wanda is every few minutes.
Wanda's my wife, Wanda.
My wife, Wanda.
Used to be married to Al. God damn it.
Wanda. Simmons!
There's a lot
Wanda!
Of
wrestling in this movie. It is BVS crossover. No shit, kid. You shit, kid. I don't know what that's a reference to. Probably the little girl in this movie.
It's probably to Zach, the kid he kind of like who takes care of Spaz for him.
Oh yeah.
Spaz is the only character I like.
Speaking of which, the dog name is Spaz.
Yeah, after one of the special effects guys in this movie.
That's how you know it's good.
By the credits of this. Oh no, it's Marilyn Manson, because that happened.
Stop. We're going to dwell on the soundtrack for a second. Mortal Kombat the movie came out, what, 95?
I think...
95 or 96.
Yeah, one of those.
Okay. Mortal Kombat the movie is arguably the best video game movie ever made. It's entertaining. Mm-hmm. It's stupid, but it's entertaining. It holds up to this day. And the soundtrack is, like, perfectly solidified in that era, and it was lots of, like, weird, like, new metal, industrial rock, and all kinds of stuff. And Spawn took... Spawn learned all the wrong lessons from that fucking movie, because the soundtrack of this movie is unbearable.
It's also, like, a copy of the soundtrack from... I'm forgetting the name of the movie now. Brad Pitt, David Fincher...
Seven?
They're not Fight Club. Seven. It's very Seven. And this movie is
very Seven. It's very Seven. It's very Hackers. The soundtrack from Hackers. Lots of the same shit. Like, it's incredibly 90s in the worst way possible.
Yeah. Ooh. I mean, this feels like the 90s just jerking off in your face.
Attitude, brah. Yeah. Attitude. Everything has to have attitude.
Yeah. I mean,
fast, man.
Yeah. Another thing from my notes is, who would let that clown near their kids?
When
he's at the birthday party? If you saw that clown, not only would you not hire that clown, you would shoot that clown in the face.
I would. That's not very property. And why is the clown? What? First of all, why does the clown have a homeless bum as his you know friend? That's the story he told.
Why are you judging, Connor?
He calls him like a
this whole podcast is about judging. Shut your mouth.
That's true too. Never mind.
He calls him like a disabled person or something. Like, I don't remember.
No,
what he said.
There was a handful of times this movie where Leguizamo's character threw out the R word.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Because it's from the '90s.
Yep.
And I asked this at least three times. It's three separate times in my notes. Is this a porn parody? I'm not sure yet. I don't know what movie it's parodying, but
it couldn't be, because it was painfully obviously knocked down to a PG-13, which I completely forgot about. And then when the movie was over, I was like, I didn't see a drop of blood in this whole film.
No, there's no blood.
It's there so
in a movie about necroplasm.
Yeah, I mean, like that's, you can get away with that. Like that's why like the first AVP could, like, I don't know, get away with so much of their violence. Because, like, none of it happened to humans. It was all just, like, big, ridiculous puppets spewing green crap out of each other.
Yeah.
You can do that all live long day. It doesn't matter. It's not, you know, it's not people violence. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it's just predators with their glowing blood and the aliens burning through stuff.
Yeah.
Can I just say? I was recently watching Alien Resurrection. I watched it.
Why would you do that?
Sorry.
I watched that to get Spawn out of my system.
Really?
I tried to exercise it out of my... I watched it to try to exercise it out of my PS4.
I need to watch a real shitty movie to get this really shitty movie out of my system.
And I said... I thought to myself... I want which is worse, Spawn or Alien Resurrection?
Spawn. I can watch Alien Resurrection pretty much any day of the week. It's like ridiculous.
It's
insane, which is why I can watch it. Like, it's filmed but it's filmed by some kind of madman. Like, every angle is bizarre looking.
Jean Pierre
Jeunet. It's incredibly violent. Even for an alien movie, like, they're violent movies, but this is like almost over the top gory.
Yeah, this is like a Verhoeven movie, Alien Resurrection, almost.
Yeah, Warwick from CSI is in it, Ron Perlman, Sigourney Weaver's, like, ridiculous real-life basketball shot that she makes.
Yeah.
That almost gets fucked
up.
Didn't
she get that one first?
It almost gets fucked up because Ron Perlman, like, basically cracks the biggest grin he can make, and they cut away immediately.
Mm-hmm. Didn't she get that, like, first try?
I think it was the sixth try, but, like, she insisted she try it, and they were like, all right, one more time. And she turns around and fucking sinks it, and Ron Perlman's like, son of a bitch. He just, like, he glows. He's like, holy God. Like,
yeah.
But I'm watching it, and I'm like, you know, I really want to see the alien newborn take on... Violator.
That'd be pretty fight. One-sided, because the newborn alien was, like, immobile and had short little legs.
Yeah.
It was like, I hate that thing.
God, yeah. There's so many things.
We said before, I love the Viler in this movie. The Viler is cool as hell.
Yeah, he's really cool in this movie. He's visually incredibly interesting. And
The design of that monster is really cool, and I'm glad they basically kept everything about it.
Yeah. And it's
Let's let your notes guide this, too, because I think it's working better than just, like, fucking shooting the shit.
This movie predicted militarized police. Hey! That was something interesting. Exposition the movie.
Jesus Christ.
Okay, yeah, this movie
I feel like I fell asleep for a second, woke up in a different podcast.
We need to talk about Terry. We need to talk about Terry and how...
D.B. Sweeney, how dare you?
Technically, in the comics, like I bought the first six, the Spawn Origins pack, off Amazon from my digitally, and I don't think the name is Terry, but in the comics, Al's best friend is black.
No, it's Terry. Yeah. Because it's the same thing across the board. I mean, it doesn't... I read the reason why they changed him from
because
black
they didn't want to have...
Stupid
because,
as hell.
It's like they didn't want to have a lot of black people in the movie.
Yeah, McFarlane, McFarlane was quoted saying he didn't want people to think the target audience was African-American.
Which, in the 90s, isn't that far of a stretch, to be honest.
Yeah.
But I still think it's bullshit.
Yeah, it's bullshit. I mean, it ultimately doesn't matter because Terry doesn't affect anything. He's just kind of there. He's mostly there to be like, I married Wanda. What do you want from me?
Just
whoops.
I can't even describe it as acting what he's doing in this movie.
He's present.
Kind of saying things with no feeling.
He just says words, and then things happen around him.
You know what he's there for? He's there to read the script.
You know who he reminds me of? He reminds me of Aaron Taylor Johnson's character from Godzilla, who's basically just a piece of wood who floats down the river of plot.
You know what? I love that movie, and I'll agree with you.
Yeah, you're wrong.
That's just because in every Godzilla movie, that's what the human exists to do.
Yeah, but like Aaron Johnson's job in that movie was to arrive at thing and look at thing and then move on to next thing.
Yep.
He's always, like, peering off in the distance, like, wow. And then, like, a catastrophe happens that completely places him in the next catastrophe, and then so on and so forth.
When I saw Terry, I was like, he looks familiar. Especially that goatee. I've seen that goatee before.
Right. It's Tom Green.
No, he was the Ravenwood guy on Jericho.
Oh,
I never watched an episode of Jericho.
It is really good.
And it sucks. It sucks that he's so poor in this movie because he is one of the main characters, if not, I would say, probably like the main character in Fire in the Sky, the scariest alien movie ever made.
Oh, shit.
Yes, he is Travis, the one who gets abducted. And like his performance while he's getting like worked on by the aliens at the end when he has his breakdown is petrifying, and it's real good, and here he is a robot.
Yeah. That's being kind. I'm serious. That's being very kind to him in this movie.
What about the other Jedi spread across the galaxy? He's also very hate Christensen-like.
Yeah, it's very close.
Master Skywalker, what are we going to do?
Die.
Terry Terrible, as it says in my notes.
Terrible. I'll see myself out.
Okay. This fucking pissed me off. There are wipes in this movie, and multiple wipes. And wipes are fine in the right, if they're used correctly. If they're in Star Wars movie.
Fire!
There is a cape wipe in this movie. There is a cape.
Can we talk about the cape for a second? The cape is, like, the most weird, like, most CG thing in this movie. Like, you just look at it and you're like, yep, that looks like it's computer generated.
Like, Spawn's coolest feature is his cape is like this endless, like, stream of, like, just whatever. And it can basically do whatever he wants it to do.
Okay, Arlen, I don't know if you'd be able to do this, but you have to do some type of Doctor Strange thing with the episode art.
Oh.
With the two capes.
I don't want to do too much work.
I don't want to talk about CG capes.
But it looks bad. I'm just going to say it.
It does look bad. And, like, I think someone mentioned before the Spawn recall. It was a fan film that was made in, like, Europe. They get the cape in that little 8-minute film because someone approaches him and his cape is literally this endless sea of... It's barely fabric. It's like it's basically an entity of its own. It's practically alive, and it's literally enveloping everything around it. It's more like Cloak from Cloak and Dagger. His cape functions like that. It is as much a part of him as his own thing. It can do practically anything. And in the movie, we learn about it in 90 seconds with Cagliostro being like, "Your cape is armor." Ah, bah, 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 bah. And then he instantly masters it and turns himself into a tank.
How did Cal... Whatever the fuck his name is. Calibrimbor. Whatever the fuck. How did he know where Spawn was at the end? He just kind of shows up, like...
Everyone just shows up. That kid just shows up and goes like, "I follow your dog here."
And that's weird.
That's how Cagliostro got the two. He's like, "YouTube it outside."
Yeah.
Wait, Hunter, this is your hang-up? No, this is...
This is your hang-up out of the whole movie was this little thing on how he got him?
Like, wasn't a bad movie.
Listen.
How the hell did he get to that house?
The whole movie's a fucking hang-up. But I'm just saying, like that moment just stood out as weird to me, because it's like, there's no way... Like, even the dog following him is kind of weird. Like, there's no way.
Yeah.
Yeah, the real reaction to a dog would be just to bite him. Not saying anything racist. You just see...
Wow, yeah. Hot takes.
Alan, you gotta stop with that shit. That's like the second time I've had to tell you to stop.
I don't know what I'm doing.
I don't know, I'm being racist.
You're like the director of this movie.
Yeah, he's like, what's his face? I don't even know his name.
Yeah, you don't need to.
Yeah.
God damn it. Yeah. Okay. Next note, after cape wipe in large letters twice, Dem chains and bedazzled bodice, those are the next two things.
The chains are cool. I like the chains. That was one of the things I did enjoy. Yeah. I like all Spawn's powers are cool as hell, and they were properly on display. Like that he can, like, his suit can basically do like whatever his mind sets it to. Like he can turn his body, he can cover his body in spikes, he can generate blades from his hands. Like I said, his cape can become armor, he can use his cape offensively. He can fly with his cape, and then he hops in a fucking motorcycle.
Yeah.
And when I was hearing this, I was like, hey, that sounds familiar. Oh, I know why. That's fucking Green Lantern.
Yeah.
Wait, what?
The can become whatever he visualizes, and
Lantern.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean the movie, right?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Fuck, we have to watch that.
God,
we have to someday, and okay, then I have a priest remain sexy, which is we kind of already went over that a little bit. Her reaction after the chain bites her leg is it takes a while for her to realize.
She does. She looks down. She kind of processes it, and then she screams.
She's like the sloth from Zootopia.
Like, for what would be like searing pain to have a piece of metal with jagged ass teeth bite into your leg,
right?
Through a big thick ass boot. She's like, it goes. She's like, oh yeah, ow.
Yeah.
Sim.
Yeah. Something that I didn't write in my notes, but I just remembered it. Their portrayal of Satanists in this movie, I found very offensive on a deeply personal level. Just such inaccuracy. Here's the thing. I would rather watch a movie about those dumb fucking Satan kids than this movie any day of the week. I would rather watch dumb, stupid teenagers try to be Satanists and try to, like, sacrifice a girl than this bullshit that we had to watch. Because, god damn it, was this movie bullshit.
Yeah.
Those kids are, like, they're the most cartoonish depiction of Satanists I've ever seen.
They look like, they look like extras from the Blair Witch 2 movie.
Yes.
Book of Shadows?
Yes. How many of us here have watched that piece of garbage?
I'll raise my hand.
We don't
have to watch it for the show.
I am not. We are not watching that here.
I'm very glad. Okay, I haven't seen it since it was on fucking VHS, so, yeah.
Fuck that movie. I refuse to see it.
Yeah.
They look like 90s metal, like, threw them up.
Yeah. Definitely. Just, like, yeah. They look like the worst possible people imaginable. They look like what I imagine Disturbed looked like before I actually saw pictures.
So they were going to kill that kid, right? It looked like they were going to for real murder him.
Yeah. And then they were talking about going and murdering a virgin also. Yeah. So that was the thing. But yeah. They just stabbing a ram's skull, which is not how that works.
Yeah, that was kind of weird.
Also reminded me of the two idiots from Hocus Pocus, like that kind of like, again, yeah. 90s
attitude.
Are you
Vulcan skull?
Yes, that's exactly what they are.
Oh my, wait. Vulcan skull are way cooler, though.
They were Satanist Vulcan skull.
Hey, wait, Vulcan skull were totally Satanists.
Are we sure about this?
I'm positive, almost.
Hunter said it here first, folks.
Yeah.
I guess. I mean, you can ask the actor about that. He'd probably tell you.
Yeah, they're going to be in that new movie, probably.
He's like, no, no, no. Looks at Hunter and goes, yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, no. I mean, no, no. Of course.
It's really surely not. The scene, okay, now the cab scene from Deadpool.
Yeah. I don't know what you're talking about. You're doing a good job.
Okay, let's save that for when we talk about Deadpool and slobber all over it.
That's going to be a fun episode. I'll watch that movie.
Watch that next, please.
We could. We'll talk about it, because I have a few ideas.
Okay, so now we're moving on
this
to my
weapon.
This was
your idea, Hunter. I really hate you for it.
Sorry.
Yeah, I feel like we should pass it off every single time. We should. But that's off show.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we're moving to my web notes, and I'm just going to read them as I typed them. They will be very fun. Whoever direction of this movie should be killed. No period.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Whoever direction of this movie should be killed. I'm not going to be that harsh.
Did you type that as whoever direction of this movie should be killed?
Whoever direction of this movie should be killed. This is what a couple shots of vodka D.
I was about to ask
vodka induced notes.
What?
These vodka induced notes?
Yes. This is
Yes.
I got through two pages on paper and then I switched to my
Oh my god.
Because I couldn't type anymore, or I couldn't write with my hand anymore, so I had to type it. And then, we already talked about this a little bit, but a clown cheerlead derp, and then what the fuck in all caps. Armageddon.
Fair enough.
I messaged the group chat when that happened, I was like, what the fuck?
Yes. Armageddon better graphics, again, referencing the video game, which is a seminal part of my life.
The Bruce Willis video game?
I don't know. All I know is that it takes place during Armageddon. You fight angels and demons and all kinds of shit, and it's as far as I can tell, far more accurate to the game than this entire movie. So that's a thing.
Hey, you guys remember Grandma's Boy? That show was a fun take on game design.
We got to tighten up the graphics on level 2.
Those pixels are very Miyamoto.
God damn it.
Okay. Oh no. Violator in all caps. Which I just, at this point, I'm just writing what I'm saying out loud, I think. I just sit myself. That's something I wrote down because that needed to be
drinking.
He admitted he was drinking. He took a couple shots.
Oh yeah.
Dude, this is at least 3 1.5 ounce shots deep, at least. I can't remember. I honestly can't.
That's not that much.
This should be much cooler than it is.
Agree to that.
Spawn Mickey is terrible. I don't know what that's a reference to.
Spawn Mickey, what?
What
Spawn talking? Mickey? I don't know what that is. I think there must be something that reminded me of Mickey Mouse.
It's fun to go into the... It's fun to have a trip into Arlen's brain while it's intoxicated.
Yeah.
Spawn Cycle, which I loved.
Okay, nope, we're talking about... I was, pretty much like, well, fuck this movie, throughout. And then... He's like, looks like I won't need these. Hands over the guns, and then, or this. Hands over the helmet. Right. Hops on a motorcycle and proceeds to get into the lamest...
Chase scene.
Silliest car chase scene I probably have ever seen this side of a Mystery Science Theater episode.
In that in that chase sequence, you actually see one of the film crews, like, little, like, crane with the little, like, camera at the end.
It actually
comes into frame.
I'm not surprised, but...
Yeah.
And like I said, he hops his motorcycle the longest route possible back to his own house he can, even though it's already been established that he can fucking fly.
Mm-hmm. It makes zero sense. At all.
No. Well, it could be worse. It could have been Skateboard Kid.
Really? Could it be worse? I would rather watch him in a skateboard. At least that'd be funny.
Yeah. Walk on a skateboard is amazing.
Skateboard Kid had a talking skateboard with the voice of Dom DeLuise.
Oh, please don't bring that up. I watch Red Letter Media, too.
I saw that on JonTron. I don't know what you guys
thought about. Yeah. Spawn Cycle gets taken out by Green Goo. Real fun.
Okay, that too. What the?
Oh,
why did the clown have a big dump truck full of green goo?
And why did he talk like a trucker the entire time?
And why?
That was dim.
Like, there's no explanation.
From
for
Roger
all of a
Rabbit.
Sudden, he's just like, oh, here comes the green goo. We're like, what is the green goo? What does it do? And then like it, he spills it all out, and like Spawn like barely crashes. His like bike just stalls out.
It tips over.
He just tips over like. He's not even bothered by it, and then he turns his motorcycle into a big old spike.
Mm-hmm.
Well before the clown crashed the car into it, he's like, I see that, and just keeps going.
Yep. Yeah.
Who then gets blown up, seemingly all the way into the air, over to Spawn's house.
Yep. And he's farting while he does it. It's...
I forgot about
that. Okay, so next note. Time for some necro goo, and then I attribution porn title. and then right after that, everybody wants to fuck Wanda, which is a running theme throughout this whole movie.
Yeah, that was
kind of weird.
Like all of a sudden, like seemingly out of nowhere, Wynn's like, "Ha, I'm gonna fuck Wanda," and then the clown all of a sudden wants to do it. Carrie has been doing it. Spawn still wants to do it.
And then the clown dies and asks Wanda if she wants some head, which is the stupidest joke. Like, I was like, seriously? That's what you're gonna go out on?
Yeah. God damn it. Yeah. I guess at some point we just cut away to Mal Baldra randomly. Like, there's no reason to it. We just cut away to him reacting to whatever's going on above Earth.
That happened frequently.
Yeah. But it really stuck with me. Jesus, these hell cutaways.
Let's talk about hell for a second. In regards to positive things about this movie.
Right.
I did say, I think I was talking to you, conceptually, this movie had a lot of cool things. Did like the look of the alley. I liked the chapel he stayed in. I think I mentioned this. It looked like if Tim Burton's original Batman was solely inspired by, like, the 90s, as opposed to, like, 1930s, 40s noir. It was very, like, 90s metal music video looking, which was cool for this.
Yeah.
And conceptually speaking, I thought hell was very interesting, even if it looks on the surface like garbage. Like, it was basically, like, it was just floating rocks and just fire and shit everywhere. The portal to hell was cool, like how people went in and out, like they were literally lit on fire and get sucked down this tube, like tube of flames. And it's just a shame that, like,